Let's consider the same matrix as before, but this time we'll beef things up. Namely, this is a real 3x3 matrix, but any real 3x3 matrix can be seen as a complex 3x3 matrix. So real numbers are complex numbers, so we can view this as a complex matrix, and we can take a look at the corresponding endomorphism of C to the power of 3. Right? There we always use R, but let's use complex numbers for a change. So this induces FA, which is now, if we now view it as a complex matrix, going from C3 to C3. We have formulated everything for abstract fields, so we can take the C with the same right as before. So this is just to keep in mind. Now we have a different situation, namely, we now view the characteristic polynomial of A is now not a real polynomial, but a complex polynomial. So we allow for complex variables. And we've seen before that chi A of t, nothing changes about that computation, is the same as t squared minus one, plus 1 times 5 minus t. Okay, so now we have a different situation, namely this equation here, t squared plus 1 equal to 0, so this factor here, this has complex solution. This would be t squared equal to 1, is equal to minus 1, and there we have the imaginary numbers. And this has the, then we can compute that this has now written as a product of factors, namely t plus I times t minus I times 5 minus t. Sorry, I just said something wrong. To get this in the form that we wanted, we can just flip things here, because this would be the same as taking minus I minus t times, and now let's add another minus in here. This would be I minus t times 5 minus t. Okay, this is just by adding additional minus here and there. So this is the form that we want now. So now, in theory, nothing speaks against being diagonalizable for this map, and it turns out it is. Namely, so if you view this as a complex matrix, it is diagonalizable. Here, from this factorization here, we get that what are the eigenvalues? These are the zeros of this complex polynomial now. Here we have minus I. So minus I, here we can get the eigenvalue I, and from the third factor we get 5 are the eigenvalues of FA, so of the complex endomorphism here now. And now I would also ask the audience, why is it diagonalizable? And it's the same argument we used in the real case before. We have three different eigenvalues, and this has dimension 3 over, again, this is viewed over the field K, so as a vector space over the field C, this has dimension 3. So this means just we have a three-dimensional space, three distinct eigenvalues, pairwise distinct eigenvalues. So it's time for this corollary again. It was corollary, what was the number? Where do I have it? 942. FA, now the corresponding complex endomorphism, is diagonalizable. So it depends really on the field. If we use the real numbers, the complex numbers, I mean, these are all fields that we are using here explicitly, but there we can, it could be diagonalizable with respect to the real number, with respect to the complex numbers, but not with respect to the real numbers. The other, sorry, another mistake, it's diagonalizable as a complex endomorphism, but not as a real endomorphism. So these are things that can happen. Now, we've seen that we can kind of see eigenvalues from these polynomials, and we have seen that if a polynomial is, if an endomorphism is diagonalizable, then the characteristic polynomial takes a particular form. But we also want to discuss the converse. We've seen that it's not enough to demand that this counterexample, that the characteristic polynomial is a product of linear polynomials. This does not suffice to get diagonalizability. But what we want to show now, and this is kind of the final statement of this chapter here, we want to see that if we have this decomposition into linear factors and another condition that we will introduce in a bit, then we will get diagonalizability. So this would be the inverse, and then we get really a statement of the form, a map is diagonalizable if and only if the following happens. Okay, so to do so, I need to prepare a bit about polynomials. And The problem is here that now in this course I have only limited time and it's not that important for you to go really deep into the theory of polynomials. There are more things you could do about eigenvalues and polynomials. If you are interested, just take a linear algebra book. If you just take standard linear algebra books, the keywords you should be using is minimal polynomials and the Cayley-Hamilton theorem. This will require a lot more effort, and then you could also say some more about the eigenvalues and study use more properties of polynomials to find eigenvalues. But this is what we will skip here at this class because this is not actually all that relevant at the moment. So let's keep it as it is. And I will, instead of going really into detail about polynomials, I will just mention now some properties and some results about polynomials and will not prove them. They are quite elementary, but this will already take some time. So let me just give them to you and you should just digest them. I mean, they look pretty, yeah, I wouldn't say obvious, but look pretty reasonable, so to say. So just leave them and, yeah, just check your favorite books if you want to see proofs of the following things. Before doing so, we make a definition, namely this property of being a product of linear polynomials. This, we want to formalize this and now say this for arbitrary polynomials. Namely, so let n in n and P, now going from k to k, polynomial of degree n. Okay, we say that P decomposes into linear factors. If the thing happened that happened for the characteristic polynomial of a diagonalizable matrix, namely if there exists some numbers a1 to an in k, such that p is given as the product of linear factors, p of t, and now I'm making one change, I'm changing the sign. I don't say a1 minus t or something, I say t minus a1 times t minus a2, and so on, t minus an. And to give some more flexibility, I'm writing here a plus minus. This always means, this notation here, this can be a plus or a minus. So the sign doesn't care. Before we had a1 minus t and so on. And if we would switch this like this, we would get minus 1 to the n, which might be a plus or a minus sign. This doesn't matter. So some sign times these nice fancy linear factors, where now this time the variable is in the first position. This is what we say decomposes into linear factors. Okay, so if f is diagonalizable, its characteristic polynomial decomposes into linear factors. This is what we have established. Now, to get a bit more into work, we need some properties of these of polynomials in general. This is theorem 955, and this is one of two results that I will now give without a proof. And this is an elementary statement. Let P be a polynomial if we have a point where the polynomial vanishes. So if a and k satisfies p of a is equal to zero, then what then? Here we have always written this as a product of something and seen the zeros from these products of the factors here. But the question is now for the converse. If we have some place where the polynomial vanishes, do we get such a factor? And this is now the beautiful fact. The answer to this is yes. If some point A satisfies P of A is zero, then there exists another polynomial which has degree one lower. Degree of Q is the degree of P minus one, such that the following holds. P of T is T minus A as a factor here times another polynomial for all T in K. So before we had these factors and saw the zeros, and this now tells us if we have such a zero, it will always pop up as a linear factor, and so we can always find such a polynomial, such that we can write this as a product of this factor and another polynomial. Meaning, if we can't find such a factor, this cannot be a zero. I mean, of course, this Q is in general not that easy to compute or something, but I mean, there is some method by which we will not study. This is kind of division by polynomials and some other results for this, but let's keep this out of this course because it's just, limited amount of time. Okay, Now, if we apply this iteratively, meaning if we apply this again and again and again, we could do the following. So here we've now kind of taken out some factor here of this of the polynomial. Now a was the zero of the polynomial p. Now this becomes obviously zero, so a does not need to be some point where this polynomial q vanishes. It might be, but it doesn't. But what we could do now is to take q and do the same thing again, because now the zeros of p, so point where p becomes zero, the zeros of p become are a and the zeros of q. So let's search for the zeros of q. So we could now search for some zero here and apply this formula again and kind of quotient out or factor out another such linear factor and do this so on and so on and so on and so on until we have no zeros anymore. And yeah, I will not prove this formally, but this is just iteration of this argument here. So this is corollary 956. If we have some polynomial over the field k, polynomial of degree n and n, then we can factor out certain commas. And of course, here we might have a again as a zero of the polynomial q, so we might factor out another copy and iterate this and so on. So we might have some arbitrary powers of this value a. So the most general point of view would be the following. Then there exist a1 to ar in k. So r is just some number. K1 to kr in n, which will be our exponents in what's to come. And another polynomial, q from k to k, with which has this property that kind of we factored out every possible zero. So we get that q of t is not equal to zero for all t in k. Okay, so something which vanishes nowhere, such that p of t is now given as this fancy product, t minus a1 to the power of k1, t minus a2 to the power of k2, and so on to t minus ar to the power of kr, q of x. Q of t. This for all t in k, and of course the total degree of the polynomial, if this is a polynomial of degree n, this must be one as well, and the degree of this, I mean the highest power occurring here in this product would be t to the k1, here we would have t to the k2, here we would have t to the kr, and here we would have some polynomial which has some degree. But it turns out the formula is then, the degree of the power of this, so of this would be a polynomial of degree k1 plus k2 plus kr and so on. So it turns out that if we take the degree of this big product, k1 plus k2, let's do the the summation sign, I from 1 to r ki, plus the degree of this, degree of q, this will be the degree of this big product, and of course this will then be the degree of p, so this must be n. This is how we can kind of find, this must be the result then. So if we have the zeros, we can really find a form of our polynomial such that we can really definitely read the zeros by just looking at this first factor and ignoring this q because this doesn't have any zeros anymore. Okay, now this is the general factorization theorem for polynomials. So this is in general how you can write this. Now, one little remark. I'm sorry, I just only realized that I made one mistake in the previous definition, namely, if it decomposes into linear factors, not only can there be a sign, there can be just some constant times this. I'm sorry I forgot this. A constant, the only thing is important that the constant is non-zero, because then this would be very simple. So C is just some number that might be in here, but otherwise we have linear factors, but we can multiply this with any number we want. I'm really sorry about this. And this constant doesn't occur because this is kind of incorporated in Q. Now, one remark. If we take the nice field of complex numbers and we take a complex polynomial, if we take a look at this, so here we get some polynomial which doesn't have zeros in K. But we've seen before that every polynomial, that was the fundamental theorem of algebra that we did in Mathematics 1, which I never proved, but I used. This fundamental theorem of algebra, told us that every complex polynomial has a zero. So this here doesn't exist, or actually it does exist because, the theorem said every non-constant polynomial. So if we just take a constant number, then this works, but this is the only case this can work for real numbers. So if we have a complex polynomial here, this guy here, this must be some constant factor. Meaning, from this we get that a complex polynomial always can be decomposed like this into linear factors. So every complex polynomial decomposes into linear factors. This is an important observation. This does not mean that every complex endomorphism is diagonalizable, because this, this was only a necessary condition or a sufficient one, but every characteristic polynomial of a complex matrix can always be factorized by this, and you can always read off the eigenvalues there. So this always works. So this follows from the fundamental theorem of algebra, plus corollary 956. So this always works. Okay, so this is only the remark because we will also deal with complex numbers in the next chapter a bit more. So much for that. So this is the basic knowledge we need about polynomials. And so we want to go back to diagonalizability. As I said, we want the criterion which says something is diagonalizable, an endomorphism is diagonalizable if and only if something holds. And for this condition that we need for this, I need another definition and to introduce some interesting numbers. So, let V be a finite dimensional vector space over K. And F be an endomorphism of V. Endomorphism. And lambda in K is supposed to be an eigenvalue. Be an eigenvalue of F. Okay, now I want to define two numbers. The first one is, I denote by m geom, so index geom of lambda comma f. This is defined as the dimension of the eigenspace. The dimension of the eigenspace of f. This number is called the, and this is why I use this geom here, the geometric multiplicity. Geometric multiplicity of lambda. Okay, now I define a second number, or maybe I should, let me erase first because this I need some bit more space for this. But this is the first kind of number that we associate with an eigenvalue, and now we will get another multiplicity defined slightly differently. Let me erase. The next number we want to associate with such an eigenvalue is the following. There is a unique number m in n, such that the characteristic polynomial of f at t. Now, lambda is an eigenvalue, so we've seen there must be some power of lambda included in this, and we want the biggest power. So this means we take the exponent m, such that we get the characteristic polynomial as this factor to the power of n times q of x, where q of lambda is non-zero. So this is a polynomial which is, q of t, where now q is a polynomial. This is something I should also mention. Q is a polynomial with Q of lambda is non-zero. So this M is unique because we have seen we can do this factorization procedure and pull out a linear factor every time we have the zero in the polynomial, but if it stops, it stops. So this means this is the highest power with which this occurs in there. So yeah, it's another way of describing this. So the highest power with which the linear factor associated with the lambda appears in the characteristic polynomial. I don't know if this is any better, but this is how you can define this number. And this number we also denote as mAlg, so alg as an index of lambda comma f. And this number is called the algebraic multiplicity. Oops, multiplicity of lambda. So we have two numbers, they are both integers, and they are both numbers we can associate with this eigenvalue. First of all, we want to make an observation about the relation between these two, and it will turn out that the relation between these two is precisely what gives us then the diagonalizability in a bit. So let's first investigate what happens, what goes in general for these numbers. Namely, there is a relation which always holds, so that V be a finite dimensional vector space over K. F from V to V an endomorphism, and lambda be an eigenvalue. Eigenvalue of F, then it always holds that the geometric multiplicity of lambda is smaller than or equal to the algebraic multiplicity of, lambda comma f is smaller than the algebraic multiplicity of lambda with respect to f. So these two numbers really satisfy this thing. And this might look a bit strange at the moment because the geometric multiplicity was the dimension of the eigenspace. Here we have this exponent in the characteristic polynomial. So it's maybe not obvious that that these numbers are related at all. I mean, they are completely differently defined. But it's actually surprisingly elementary to see why this relation holds. Now, put just to abbreviate the notation, n is supposed to be the dimension of V, and R is shorthand for the geometric multiplicity. Okay, the dimension of the eigenspace. So, what we now do is to choose a basis of the eigenspace. Take an ordered basis B1 to BR, be an ordered basis. I mean, by definition now, the spaces are dimensional, the eigenspace of associated with lambda or corresponding to lambda, be an ordered basis of E lambda F. Okay. So we have a basis of the subspace, and by the basis extension theorem, we can extend this to a basis of the of all of V. So basis extension theorem can extend this to a basis which I will call B, which now has so it's an ordered basis, I've written this down, B1 to BR, and then we just fill up with remaining vectors, and the basis extension theorem tells us we can do this to BN. Okay, so this is now a basis of V, of course. Okay, so how does this help us? We now want to look at the matrix representation with respect to these, to this basis here. So by definition of eigenvectors, what does the matrix representation of F with respect to B look like? This has a particular form, namely MB of F. So what happens here? So in the first R rows, so let's make this a bit easier. Okay, so let's say these are These are the first r rows. These are the remaining n minus r rows, and this is these are n minus r columns. These are r columns. So this part here is, so I mean the column vectors are the images of the base vectors. This is what we've learned. And it means that if I take a vector bj from this first j vectors here, so how is this, if f of bj, how is this given as a linear combination of these base vectors? Bj is an eigenvector to the eigenvalue lambda. So it would be just, the column should just contain lambda times bj and nothing else, which means now in terms of these matrices that in the jth column we need to have lambda in the jth part and everything else is zero. And the same goes here, like if we take the first basis vector, this would be f of b1 is lambda b1 plus zero times all the others. So the first column is lambda, zero, and so on, and the rest is only zero. Especially here, these are all zeros. And the same goes for all the eigenvectors there. So here we would have zero, lambda, to zero. For the second one, these are all zero. So until finally we get for the rth base vector, I mean this is here the index rr, the point where I'm putting my finger now, this would also contain a lambda because this would be just lambda times br and the rest is zero. And yeah, here we only have zeros here in the bottom left corner, in this corner, and here we have something which we don't know. I mean this would be some, as I write this as block matrix, I call this A and I call this C. Now this, to write this a bit shorter, MBF is, and now as a block matrix, lambda times the identity matrix of rank R, zero matrix down there, here and here we have some matrices A and C. Okay, this is an R by R matrix, this would be an N minus R by R matrix, the zero matrix here, and these are just some matrices. I don't write down the number of rows and columns here because this is kind of not that interesting. The interesting thing is we have this as a block matrix here. So here are some numbers we don't know, but this is the part we know. And we've seen a formula. This is again what we, I think we already used it today, the determinant of block matrices of this particular form where there's a zero on the one side, on the one corner here. This is now easy to determine because this is now by sheet, again the same exercise, I've written this down, yeah, exercise 3A from sheet 5. The determinant of this gives us, so this would be chi f of t, this is the determinant then of, not of this, but sorry, of mbf minus t times the identity matrix of rank n. So if we do this, this would be the determinant, let me start here again. Chi f of t is then the determinant, and this now means we need to subtract t everywhere in the diagonal. And if we do this, this means basically in this block matrix notation that here in this part here, this is R by R, so the first R by top left R by R matrix, here it would be just lambda times the identity minus T times the identity matrix of size R. So this would be lambda minus T times I R. So here in the top bottom left corner, we have just zeros and don't add anything, so here would be a zero. This would also stay as it is, and here we would have to take C minus T times the identity matrix of rank N minus R. Okay, so this is just how the Kirk's polynomial is given. This matrix I just want to call B of T. B is already given, sorry. Let's call it D of T. So this is some matrix which depends on T, we don't care at the moment. Now we can use this formula, this is now what we use here, so this is exercise 3, sheet 5. So this is the determinant of this times the determinant of this. So this would be the determinant of lambda minus t times ir times the determinant of d of t. So if we just take a look at what this means, this would mean we have the determinant of the matrix which has lambda minus t on the diagonal entries and zeros everywhere else. Okay, this is an R by R matrix times the determinant of D of T. And this part, this is just some polynomial in T, so let's call this Q of T. And the determinant of the diagonal matrix is again just the product of the diagonal entries, and we have lambda minus T to the power of R, it's just R times, so this is lambda minus T to the power of R times Q of T. Okay, so maybe let me write the whole thing again. So chi f of t is t lambda minus t to the power of r q of t. So which would be, just to get the form that we wanted, minus 1 to the power of r of t minus lambda to the power of r q of t. So this is some polynomial which might be zero at lambda or it might not. So we have are many factors here, so we might get additional factors from here. So the algebraic multiplicity of lambda here in this polynomial might become bigger, but it must be at least R. So this might be zero or not. So here it follows that the algebraic multiplicity of lambda must be R or bigger. And R was the geometric multiplicity, so this is what we wanted to show. Just because of this behavior of the polynomials. So this indeed holds. The geometric multiplicity is at most the algebraic multiplicity of eigenvalues. Okay, now we come to the criterion for diagonalizability, which I've been indicating already. Namely, it turns out we can, if we know that the characteristic polynomial decomposes into linear factors, and if we know something about these multiplicities, then we get diagonalizability. So again, V finite dimensional vector space over K, vector space over K, guess what, F an endomorphism. Then the following are equivalent. One, F is diagonalizable. And two, first of all, chi F decomposes into linear factors. And the geometric multiplicity of any eigenvalue lambda is the same as the algebraic multiplicity. Whoops. For all eigenvalues. So the multiplicities have to coincide, then we get equivalence. For all eigenvalues lambda in K of F. This is the main criterion here we need for diagonalizability. Okay, how do we see this? Let's first of all introduce some notation just for bookkeeping. So let lambda 1 to lambda k be the pairwise distinct eigenvalues. Eigenvalues of f. And that n be the dimension of the vector space V. Okay, and now let's get on. So we need to show the equivalence of these two. So first of all, we assume the map is diagonalizable and want to show that these properties follow. This is maybe the less exciting direction. Namely, we've seen the first part already by theorem 51. We've seen that chi f decomposes into linear factors. Okay, this is what we already know. Now, we need to check that if it's diagonalizable, then also the multiplicities coincide, but this is also basically a very simple computation, namely put, first of all, that the algebraic multiplicity be denoted by ni, so the multiplicity of lambda I is just ni, m arg of lambda I f for all I between 1 and k. Okay, then the characteristic polynomial, if the way we look at it, we know this coefficient, we know that then, since it's diagonalizable, so it decomposes into linear factors, we get chi f of t is the same as minus 1 to the n, and now t minus lambda 1 to the power of n 1 times t minus lambda 2 to the power of n 2, and so on to t minus lambda k to the power of nk for all t in k. Okay, now we know that the degree, I mean, we not only see this as a product of factors, of linear factors here, but we know that was what we've seen already. I have mentioned this in this remark. The degree of the characteristic polynomial is always the dimension of the space. This is n. So what we get from this is that here we see the what is the degree of this expression here. Here we have t to the n minus 1 as the biggest power. Here we have t to the n 2 and so on. So by the power laws, if we multiply this, this is t to the sum of the exponents. So it follows that the sum from I equals 1 to k of n I must be equal to n. But this is something this is the sum of the multiplicities here. But since, by assumption, f is diagonalizable, we've seen, and that was a criterion for diagonalizability in terms of the decompositions into eigenspaces. This is by theorem 941. We get that, the sum from 1 to k of the geometric multiplicities, although we didn't call them that way, lambda I f, this is by definition the same as the sum of the dimensions of the eigenspaces. And this was the theorem, this precisely said if it's diagonalizable, then we get that the sum of the dimensions must be the dimension of V, so it must be n. So, let me do this right here at the end. So maybe make this a bit smaller. Oops, this is economical. Okay, now we see that the sum of the geometric multiplicities is n, but this here is the sum of the algebraic multiplicities. So we've shown that in particular the sum of the geometric multiplicities of the lambda I equals the sum of the algebraic multiplicities. But we've also seen by the previous lemma that, so this was lemma 959, the geometric multiplicity of lambda I is smaller than or equal to the algebraic multiplicity of lambda I. Comma f for all I in 1 to k. Yeah, now I'm almost ready, almost done. Just need one little bit, squeeze this in here. Now I'm overly economical, but anyway. So just remember, just take a look at what we've shown. We've shown that the sum of the multiplicities is the same, but each of the individual summons are at most the upper summons. So we can only have that they are up to the same sum if each of the summons are the same, because otherwise if one of them would be smaller than the one, we would already have lost. Then we would have kind of the weakest link, the sum would have to be smaller than. So because of this inequality and this sum, this directly implies that the geometric multiplicity lambda I f must be the same as the algebraic multiplicity of lambda I with respect to f for all I in 1 to k, and this shows what we wanted. So any diagonalizable endomorphism has this property here, and now let me erase and then it will show you the converse. Then we will see why this already ensures diagonalizability. You might now think that this direction must be very complicated, but it turns out it is simple. It's even simpler than the previous direction. Now, take the following line of argument. So we know that chi f decomposes into linear factors. This is the assumption, into linear factors. But this means, by definition of the algebraic multiplicities, that the sum of the algebraic multiplicities must be the degree of chi f, and this is n, the dimension. So we get the sum from 1 to k, yes, sorry, 1 to k, m alg of lambda I f must be equal to n. But now, since by assumption the algebraic multiplicities and the geometric multiplicities coincide, we get that, so let me start with dim v, this is equal to n, this is equal to the sum of the algebraic multiplicity, m algebraic of lambda I f. Now, by assumption, this is the same as the sum of the geometric multiplicities, m geom lambda I f. But now, how are they defined? They are the dimensions of the eigenspaces. This is the sum of the dimensions of E lambda I f. So, we see that the dimension of V is the dimension of the eigenspaces, and then we're done. Because we've already seen by this theorem from one of the previous sections that in this case, this implies that V decomposes this is a direct sum of the eigenspaces there. So, and this means V is diagonalizable. So, this was part of theorem, I had the number, forgot it again, 941. This already implies that F is diagonalizable. And this completes the proof. Now, to give the section some closure, this is now everything we need about diagonalizable endomorphisms. And now we've got everything at hand to find out if an endomorphism is diagonalizable or not. Now, how do we do this? Let's maybe summarize, and this is now just lining out what we did so far. We line out the method for diagonalization of an endomorphism. So what can we do if we get, so for diagonalization of an endomorphism F from V to V? So let's take a look, what do we need to do? So how to decide if an endomorphism is diagonalizable? Basically, we just need to put in everything we did in this section. First of all, we compute the characteristic polynomial. So take a matrix representation and compute this. So, and then we have to check if it does not decompose into linear factors. This is an example we had today. Decompose into linear factors. So this is a bit like an algorithm. If it does not decompose into linear factors, then F is not diagonalizable. And we're done. It's not diagonalizable. Then F is not diagonalizable. So in the next step, if we want to show, if we now have this criterion that it's really decomposed into linear factors, so if this does not hold, if chi f decomposes into linear factors, we can first of all read off the eigenvalues from the linear factors. The eigenvalues. And what we also get is, of course, the algebraic multiplicities. They are just the exponent there. And algebraic multiplicities. Okay, so to see if it's diagonalizable, we need to find out the geometric multiplicities. And they are now, so we know the eigenvalues, we know these multiplicities. So we now need to know the dimensions of the eigenspaces. And now the dimensions of the eigenspaces can be computed, and this is now probably the most yeah, most annoying part maybe. Compute m geom of lambda f for each eigenvalue lambda. And what do we do? By computing the dimension of the solution set, of f minus lambda times the identity of v of x is zero. This is the eigenspace, the kernel of this map. And now, okay, you might think, okay, great, what does this help me? This is something you can really do explicitly by just choosing matrix representations. If you take matrix representations and compute the dimension of the corresponding matrix equation here, this would be an equation that's a matrix times a vector is zero. So this is a homogeneous system of linear equations, and this is what we can solve. So to solve this, choose matrix representation, and then use Gaussian elimination and so on. So this is what we learned. We learned how to solve systems of linear equations. So this is the next procedure. Okay, by this procedure you get the solution set, and in particular you get the dimension of the solution set, and then you get the geometric multiplicities. And so then we kind of have the final step for diagonalizability. So if m geom of lambda, which we just computed, is the same as m alg of lambda f, which we computed in step two, for all eigenvalues lambda, then f is diagonalizable, otherwise it's not diagonalizable, because that was an if and only if statement. Diagonalizable, otherwise not. Okay, and if we now want to do everything, basically, if we know that the matrix is an endomorphism is diagonalizable, so we have decided this, but also for computations it's not enough, because we know, so diagonalizability means we have a basis such that the matrix representation is diagonal, so we have a beautiful matrix representation, so to say. And of course we also want this representation, we want to find the basis that's correct in this, that's doesn't this way. And if we now trace back everything we did so far, if if f is diagonalizable, if we have found this out, then we can use our computations again, so the results of the computations of the geometric multiplicities. And then we computed these solution sets, so results of step three. And what we can do now is to find basis of these solution sets, meaning basis of the eigenspaces that we have discussed there so far, to find basis of the eigenspaces. Basis of f. So this we have to do, of course, for each eigenvalue individually, but we can find these bases. And now what we can do is to merge them. Take all of them together. And then we know by the diagonalizability, if we have bases of all the eigenspaces, they form an eigenbasis by definition of an eigenbasis to get an eigenbasis B of f. And then it turns out, and this is what we've discussed a few sections ago, mbf with respect to an eigenbasis is diagonal. So if we have an endomorphism which is diagonalizable, this is really a procedure you can just follow. I mean, it's an algorithm, it's just some recipe. Basically, you just have to follow the instructions here to get your eigenbasis. Of course, this involves quite some computations, but assuming that for practical problems, we can do this with a computer, for example, then this becomes something doable. This is what you can just tell a computer to do. This is like an algorithm, and so we can really do this to really explicitly find, if we're given an endomorphism, which we know to have this nice property, we can find a beautiful coordinate representation which might simplify our problems or our situations that we're actually discussing. Okay, this is the end of chapter 9. In I would now really love at this point to talk about some applications of eigenvalues, because there are several in physics or in other situations, and unfortunately, because I just don't have enough time, I really need the time for the course for the rest of the course to do so. There's also nice connections between linear differential equations and eigenvalues. I might come back to this at the end of the semester. Let's see how much time I will have by then. But at this point, I will not go further into detail on the application side, but I want to give you a link to a nice video where you see a nice application, namely, so this will be in the comment of this video, so somewhere below. There is a beautiful and very famous applications of this, namely Google. When Google, so back in the days, so from your perspective, it's probably shortly after World War II. Back in the days when Google didn't exist, there were a lot of search engines on the internet. There were like Yahoo, Alta Vista, in Germany there was Lycos, and others and others and others. And the results were all like, they would really differ from if you put something into a search engine, they would show you a lot of results, but maybe the order was strange. So something, there would be something on top which is not that interesting or not that relevant, and you have to dig a bit and take the first pages and so on. And then at some point Google popped up, so in the early 2000s probably, should be. And Google was so popular and became immensely popular from the beginning because the quality of the search of the matches there was much better than for the other search engines. Because there, like as you do now and as you are probably, given your young age, are used to, you type something into Google and the, like if you would type, for example, in person into Google, the first thing would be kind of the Wikipedia page. Then you would get some things else related, maybe their social media accounts or like, I don't know, if it's an actor, you would find some list of films or whatever. I mean, the quality is just good. So the first matches you get are usually those that are the most interesting for you. So Google works really well in that respect for these systems. If you would type mathematical terms into Google, sometimes if you get really specialized, Google is not that good, actually. But anyway, so this is why Google is so good, because it had a new algorithm. It has the so-called PageRank algorithm. It's not, by the way, the name is not because it ranks pages, or maybe it is a pun, but because it was invented by Larry Page, who was one of the two founders of Google. So the interesting thing was that they used a linear algebra method. They actually used eigenvalues. The idea was kind of you have a lot of websites and you want to rank them. You want to give them a number and say kind of the highest number should go first and so on. These numbers were then obtained as eigenvalues in a really theoretical procedure. The very rough idea is like kind of you assume you have a finite set of web pages, for example, I don't know, 5 million websites or something, and then you put a matrix in there with 5 million columns and 5 million rows, so a very, very, very huge quadratic matrix. And in the ij part in the matrix, you just put a 1 if matrix I has a link to website j, and put a 0 if it doesn't. So this would then, I mean, of course, since most pages don't set links to each other, most of this matrix will be 0, and this is why these things are still computable. But you will have a matrix with 1 and zeros, and it turns out the eigenvalues of these matrices, of this procedure that you get for the matrix there, they really tell us kind of how popular a website is by how often it is referred to. So this is the big idea there. And there's I found a nice video on YouTube where this is explained in a bit more detail, but it should be understandable for you with what you already know about endomorphisms and eigenvalues and matrices and so on. So if you want to just enjoy the video and see that kind of this is really a practical application of linear algebra, just where that's the website, the method that Google is actually based on. And of course it was extended, but this is a nice example for that. Okay, so much about eigenvalues. In the next chapter, I will do you some kind of favor because we will not work with arbitrary abstract fields anymore, but we will stick to the real and complex numbers. And we will do something that we haven't done yet, but this is kind of the idea if you compute with vectors, and the idea is kind of also what you maybe saw in high school, otherwise at university, and you have vectors as points in Rn, and you imagine them as kind of arrows, or as points that have some distance from another, that have a length, so a vector which is, you want to have some length, and so on, and you have the notion of angles between two vectors, so what's the angle between them, and so on. And this is something we haven't formalized yet, because we kind of need to find a way to measure lengths inside a vector space, and to measure quantities, so angles, and so on. This is what we haven't done so far, and this is what we will do in the next chapters. It will be about inner products and norms, and this will hopefully be a bit less abstract and maybe more pleasant for some of you. See you in the next chapter.